So if you're watching this video, I'm pretty sure that at some point in your life or in the lives of someone you know, they've had the flu. Almost everybody is pretty familiar with how awful it feels to get sick with the flu. And when people talk about the flu, they kind of talk about it in two different ways. And we're gonna get into both of those ways right now. So sometimes they'll talk about the illness or the symptoms they had when they had the flu. And other times they'll talk about the virus, you know, the actual virus that causes the flu. So I'm going to actually break it down the same way. We're going to talk first about the illness, and then we're going to get into the virus. I'm going to draw a nice little line down the middle so that we don't get lost in this conversation. So I can't help it, but anytime I hear that someone has the flu, I immediately get into this mode where I have a bunch of questions for them, and I really just want to kind of convince myself that when they say they have the flu, they really have the flu and they don't have something else. So the questions that pop up in my head, the first one is usually, is it abrupt or did it kind of start abruptly? I'm going to just write that. Was it abrupt? And, you know, I might say, do you remember feeling well one evening and then waking up sick or something like that? Do you remember exactly kind of when it started? And most people with the flu can tell you within a day or two exactly when their illness started. Now, another clue that something is the flu is that it usually lasts for about 3 to 7 days. So if someone is saying, well, I got sick with the flu and then 4 months later, you know, I started getting better, that's a very weird story. Usually it would be a lot quicker than that. So always think around 3 to 7 days. Of course, it could be a few extra days than that, especially when you're thinking about a symptom like the cough. But generally speaking, that's the time window. Then I really get into the symptoms themselves. I want to find out exactly what made them feel so sick. And there are two categories of symptoms. The first is respiratory symptoms. I want to know about respiratory symptoms. And secondly, I want to know about what I call constitutional symptoms. Constitutional symptoms. And this has nothing to do with the Constitution, but it has to do with the body, kind of thinking about symptoms that affect the entire body. So let me make a little bit of space on the canvas, and we'll first start out thinking about the respiratory side. So respiratory symptoms, let me draw out air coming into the body. Remember, air has two major paths into your body. It's going to come in through your nose, or it's going to come in through your mouth, right? And when it comes in, it's going to quickly join up. Remember, air in the nose is going to meet up with air in the mouth, and it's going to go down through the windpipe, or the trachea, we call it, and it's going to branch off into the right and left lung. So this is my right lung over here, and on the other side, we've got the left lung. And remember, the left lung is also going to be right next to the heart, so we've got to keep a little space for the heart. So these are the two lungs, and this is the air coming in. Now, if someone says that they have a stuffy nose, that's a really common one, right? They say they're congested, or sometimes they might say a runny nose, but any of these kinds of symptoms, you can think in your mind of this picture and you can say, well, yep, this is right along the path that air is going to take on its way into the lungs. So this is part of the respiratory tract. Now, another symptom might be a sore throat. And here again, you can see that the air is actually going to be passing right through the throat on its way down into the lungs. And a really, really common symptom, you hear this all the time, is cough. And whenever people talk about cough, I just usually think about the lungs being involved there. So these symptoms, stuffy nose, sore throat, cough, you can think of this picture and really you can visualize the air going through and somehow these parts are being involved. Now, exactly what's happening is that the virus is, of course, coming in, right? It's being breathed in. That's how we take in the flu virus. And as it hits these different areas, the cells are getting damaged. And that's what we experience as a stuffy nose or a sore throat or a cough. It's really damaged cells that are being affected by the virus. Now, moving on to the other side, the constitutional symptoms, these are symptoms that I want you to think of as affecting the whole body. So this is the whole body. Let's say these are the arms and the legs. These are symptoms like fever. Now, if someone says they have fever, it's very hard to point to one exact part of the body that's affected, right? You might say, well, I feel feverish really all over. And if you're feeling feverish, this face would be very sad like that. So if you have symptoms like fevers, and with fevers, oftentimes you get chills as well. I'm going to put that together. If you have fevers or chills, that would be a constitutional symptom. Another one would be something like body aches. You know, if you are in bed because your whole body is aching, you wouldn't point to any one place. You'd say, well, it's just kind of all over. And so that would be another constitutional symptom. Another one that jumps to mind is fatigue, kind of the same idea, where your whole body is affected here. So again, when someone tells me about flu, I'm thinking that they better have at least one of these respiratory symptoms and at least one of these constitutional symptoms. So I think of them in two categories, right? And I want at least one from each category. And they must have both if they're going to get me convinced that they have the flu. So scrolling up just a little bit, just to make sure we don't forget, it's got to be abrupt. It's got to happen over the course of 3 to 7 days. And they should have at least one respiratory symptom and at least one constitutional symptom. Now, this is good if I'm taking care of patients or I'm, you know, thinking about a clinical setting like the hospital or the emergency room. But what about if you're doing research? Well, it turns out that the Centers for Disease Control, and they do a lot of research around influenza and flu, they have a definition that I want you to know about. Their definition, and you'll see this, is that the person has to have a sore throat or a cough, one or the other. I'll put a big or here. And they have to have fevers. So this is very similar to the definition I just gave you, but this is the definition they use when doing research and when actually presenting data. So it has to have these two things, right? Sore throat or a cough and fevers. And so this is the definition for influenza-like illness. Influenza-like illness. And the short way of saying all this is ILI, influenza-like illness. So this again is the definition from the Centers for Disease Control. So if you ever hear ILI, at least now you know what they're considering as being someone that has ILI. So this brings up kind of an interesting question, and that's why I kind of started out by splitting things up between the illness and the virus. I want to go over to the virus side and just keep in the back of your mind this idea of ILI. Now on the virus side, let me just kind of sketch out very quickly in this green color what the influenza virus looks like. I'm going to label this influenza over here. So this is my influenza virus, and this little virus has got some RNA on the inside of it. So it's got RNA in here, and I'm going to draw out the RNA just so you can see it. I'm going to use two different colors. So let's use like a purple color here. And one important thing about this RNA is that it's broken up into little pieces the way I'm drawing it here. So it's got some purple chunks, and let's draw some yellow chunks of RNA as well. And this RNA, of course, is, as I said, genetic material, so it's going to be coding for proteins. So you've got some proteins, and let's say that you've got some proteins out here on the surface. And, you know, you could imagine that those yellow proteins come from one of those yellow RNA segments. And you've also got some purple proteins over here, some purple proteins. I'm going to draw out some purple proteins here for you. So let's say that the purple protein, we can call that H, and the yellow protein, we can call that N. So what you're getting here is that you're seeing a couple of the important parts of influenza virus that I just wanted you to start getting familiar with. The fact that it has, you know, RNA on the inside, that it's broken up into chunks, that it's got some surface proteins on the outside, and a couple of those important ones, we call them H and N for short. And I'll tell you more about them in a future video. So this is influenza virus. And now the question is, if you have someone, let's say I've got a friend or a family member who tells me that they had an abrupt illness that was 6 days and they had fevers and a cough. Well, it sounds like, based on what I said, that this meets, of course, the CDC definition for influenza-like illness. And so if I tested them, let's say I actually, you know, checked their nose with a little nose swab and did a test, you would expect that I would actually find influenza in there. And most of the time, I would actually find influenza there. But not always, and this is actually an important concept, that there are actually, believe it or not, some of these little copycat viruses. I'm going to draw a couple copycat viruses here for you. I'm going to write out two of them. There are actually more than two, but we're just going to talk about two of them. And I'm not going to draw them accurately. This is just kind of a visual representation, just to kind of show you what they are and write up their names. One is called rhinovirus. And you may be aware that rhino means nose. And actually, rhinovirus loves to infect the nose. And that's actually why it's called rhinovirus. And another copycat virus, I'm going to draw it looking a little different, maybe a sideways looking thing, something like this. This guy, this is RSV. RSV. And the full name of RSV is respiratory, so you know it affects the lungs, syncytial virus, respiratory syncytial virus. And we'll talk about that another time as well. But the idea here, guys, is that these copycat viruses, and this is interesting, they can actually sometimes fool us into thinking that we're dealing with influenza. Because some of the symptoms you get with rhinovirus and that you get with RSV end up being pretty similar to the symptoms you get with the flu. And so as a result, we have to have some way of telling them apart. And that's why, actually, you may have heard of the term the cold. Let me actually bring this down and actually show you now the cold and the flu side by side and how to kind of distinguish between the two. So when you have, let's say, the flu, we said that usually you would have some respiratory symptoms, check, and you'd have some constitutional symptoms, check. But if you have the cold, kind of the common cold, we call it, then you generally only have respiratory symptoms. You don't typically have fevers and chills and body aches and fatigue. You don't usually have that stuff with the cold. So that's kind of the easy and quick way to distinguish between the flu and the cold. And those are the questions I always ask, you know, patients of mine. I say, well, did you have body aches or fatigue? And if the answers to all those kinds of questions are no, I'm thinking, aha, this person has the cold. But of course, this isn't exact, right? This isn't perfect. And that once in a while, people will actually fool you and they will actually have one of these copycat viruses, the rhinovirus or RSV or adenovirus, there are many other ones, and they'll actually have influenza-like illness. They'll actually have sore throat and fevers and body aches. And so this is important to know that every single time we clinically think someone has, you know, flu illness, doesn't necessarily mean that they have the influenza virus.